Midweek greetings to you all out there. Televiewers on my media prime, is another beautiful day in the nation's economic capital, Douala. You are on to your favorite bilingual program, The Brief, where we get to dig several layers beneath the striking headlines relayed by newspapers in the country. On today's edition of the program, the newspapers are relaying this morning the deplorable states of the Babaju-Bamenda stretch of road, not leaving out the Lake Chad Basin Commission meeting, which is ongoing in Abuja, Nigeria. Thank you for tuning in. And Audrey Zatsa is already around. Here are the headlines in the French language. Bonjour, Audrey Zatsa.
Bonjour à toi, Lasha Kingsley. Bonjour à vous, très chers et fidèles téléspectateurs. Merci de nous rejoindre une fois de plus sur Débrief. Nous débutons donc la première partie de cette émission avec la lecture, naturellement, des journaux. Comment Gongo a repris le pouvoir? C'est le titre que propose le journal par lequel nous débutons ce matin, le journal Le Feu, puis Njawe, le messager, et qui en parle à sa une. Et d'après lui, sur la base d'un rapport vertement critiqué, le secrétaire général à la présidence de la République a réussi à s'adjuger la gestion de la lutte contre le Covid-19 et neutraliser ses adversaires. Vous aurez donc plus d'informations dans la page 3 du journal Le Messager que vous retrouverez dans les kiosques à journaux ce matin. Poursuivons avec Le Jour qui parle de tournoi de boxe, comment un voyage pour la Russie s'est arrêté à Dubaï. D'après le journal, le voyage de la délégation camerounaise composée de 8 athlètes s'est arrêté à mi-chemin. Vous aurez davantage dans la page 11. Le journal parle également des marches pacifiques. 27 militants du MRC maintenus en prison, d'après ce qu'on pourra lire dans le journal plus tard à l'Infogay. Le trésorier national du mouvement pour la renaissance du Cameroun et Olivier Bibou Missak, le porte-parole de Maurice Kamto, était devant la cour d'appel au centre à Yaoundé hier. Donc ils étaient là pour dans le cadre d'une procédure de mise en liberté immédiate, procédure introduite devant cette juridiction par les avocats des prévenus. Ces personnes ont été inculpées par le tribunal militaire de Yaoundé pour tentative de rébellion, révolution, attroupement aggravé et défaut de carte nationale d'identité et bien d'autres encore. Donc l'affaire a été adjournée une fois de plus. Poursuivons avec le journal Le Témoin qui parle de Covid-19. Manaouda Malachi, victime de son efficacité, c'est ce que pense le journal Le Témoin ce matin. D'après lui, il a donner un nouveau visage à la fonction ministérielle. Sa jeunesse et son dévouement ont fait de lui la cible à abattre. Décryptage d'une affaire dont les faits blanchissants dont les faits blanchissent le mine santé. C'est dans les pages 3 et 4 que vous lirez donc ce décryptage. Terminons avec l'œil du Sahel qui parle de parc national de la Bénoué. 360 orpailleurs clandestins interpellés dans le cadre d'une opération menée le 18 mai 2021 par les forces de défense camerounaises. Plus de 50 orpailleurs ont été appréhendés dans le parc national de la Bénoué, réserve animalière de la région du Nord du Cameroun, donc, dont le sous-sol est réputé très riche en minerais. Le parc est devenu la cachette des malfaiteurs et comme les orpailleurs constituent une source d'approvisionnement de ces derniers, ils peuvent survivre dans le parc. De fait, ces orpailleurs, les malfaiteurs ne peuvent pas y être. Malheureusement, parmi les orpailleurs, il y en a qui sont aussi des malfaiteurs armés. C'est ce que a expliqué une source sécuritaire au trihebdomadaire régional L'Œil du Sahel. En plus de la recherche de l'or, ces orpailleurs, selon les services de sécurité, aident généralement au ravitaillement, au camouflage des preneurs d'otages et autres braconniers, devenant ainsi complices, voire acteurs de l'insécurité dans la partie septentrionale du Cameroun. Voilà, mesdames, messieurs, pour les tabloïds en langue française. Place au tabloïd dans langue anglaise avec toi, Lasha Kingsley.
Thank you, Audrey Zatsa. Let's kick start with the Guardian Post newspaper, which is, of course, continuing with its series on the deplorable state of the Bamenda-Babaju stretch of road, enhancing separatist agenda, writes the Guardian Post newspaper. According to the paper, government's indifference to the deplorable state of the Bamenda-Babaju route, political observers hold, could be a strong indicator that the BS regime has learnt and forgotten nothing from the more than 5 years old conflict, that's the Anglophone crisis, that has since morphed into an armed conflict. The same analysts are wondering how Yaounde could afford the luxury of toying with the temperament of a people who in the first place are nursing a grudge against the BS regime for treating them as second-class citizens in a country they call theirs. More details in this edition of the Guardian Post newspaper. And the Guardian Post is equally interested in the ongoing Lake Chad Basin Commission meeting holding in Abuja, the political capital of Nigeria. According to the paper, Bia is conspicuously absent at the strategic Lake Chad Basin Commission a meeting of the six heads of states of member countries. Bia was the only absentee at the yesterday's conclave in Abuja, the political capital of Cameroon. He was represented by the Secretary General at the Presidency of the Republic of Cameroon, Ferdinand Ngongo. We continue with the National Post. The National Post newspaper this morning took interest in the COVID-19 vaccine in the country. Vaccination ongoing amidst COVID gates, writes the National Post newspaper. The National Post went ahead to say during the statistics or drawing this statistics from the education of the COVID-19 immunization campaign, Minister Manaoda Malachi on a tweet disclosed that about 48,226 have been so far vaccinated. Thus, Cameroonians have so far been vaccinated against the COVID-19 in the country amid COVID gate. You can get more details of the National Post newspaper this day in the country. Let's leave the National Post newspaper. We are with the National Bilingual Daily Cameroon Tribune. Cameroon Tribune this morning is interested in the security meeting of the Lake Chad Basin Commission, which is holding in Abuja, the political capital of Nigeria. The paper says member states of the Lake Chad Basin are remobilizing to ensure that their countries or countries that are found within the Lake Chad Basin are protected. You can get more details about the meeting which opened in Nigeria yesterday. And of course, the President of the Republic of Cameroon was represented by Ferdinand Ngongo, Secretary General at the Presidency of the Republic of Cameroon. We are back in the studio and we are with our guest who is coming from Mandela Foundation. He is a human rights defender. Amadu Tarnteh is with us this morning. Good morning, Amadu Tarnteh, and thank you for coming. This is the very first time we are having you on our platform.
Good morning, Mr. Lasha, and good morning, Madam Audrey. It's a pleasure for me to be in your program today. Permit me greet one or two people. I will hereby greet my mentor, Dr. Hile Kamga, and the executive director of Nouveau Droit de l'Homme, Madam Celine Roland Béchon, and the entire population of Cameroon in particular, and the population of the Northwest and Southwest who have been going through pains for the past 4 or 5 years today.
So how is the human rights situation in the country?
The human rights situation in the country, according to the best of my knowledge, is very deplorable. The situation is very absurd. In fact, it is questionable. We don't understand why a country will sign and ratify international convention, but is not ready to live by them.
Okay, let's begin this morning with the Guardian Post newspaper, which is interested in the Bamenda-Babaju stretch of route. The deplorable nature of that route is still very much a news item with the Guardian Post newspaper. This route has been there in a very deplorable state. People are traveling to Bamenda and even the west region of the country. They find it so difficult to cross that 37 kilometer stretch of road.
indeed the situation is very aching. And every onlookers have questioned why the Bamenda state of road is still the way it is today. Because from the way we see things going, we don't really understand what is happening. It seems as if there is something behind the route where we don't, or behind this, why the route is not being tied up to today that we don't know. Because whatsoever the government is doing, we don't understand. Maybe it's government that is indirectly pushing these people for enhancing whatsoever is going on, or maybe the what is going on between the armed separatists the armed separatists in the Anglophone region who are fighting for their freedom. Because when the government abandoned the people, at the same time when the people are fighting for more than 4 years of the same marginalization, and you see allow the route, the stretch of route that is linking the French part of the country to the Anglophone or in Northwest region, it has made most of us question. We have condemned these things on many circumstances. Last time we saw the Minister of Public Work who went on the ground and assured the population that in very few period of time the situation will be stable. In fact, the route, he assured that he was going to closely monitor the situation until the route is finally done. But up to date, the situation keeps worsening. Well, we don't know exactly what is happening.
And
les travaux tardent de ce côté-là à cause de la crise sécuritaire. On parle, n'est-ce pas, de la sécurité également des travailleurs.
Les séparatistes ont eu à brûler certains engins qui étaient for the company and the construction company.
Well, I think it's just normal for the minister to do everything possible to defend himself or to defend his government, but normally what we are seeing on the field is not the situation, because there are so many other routes in the Anglophone region that has been tagged despite the insecurity situation. But last time there was a route, I think it should be the Bamenda Manfe set of road when this guy started. The machines or the tractors were about working on the field were burned on several occasions by several spiders, but the government assured security along the stretch of road and the route was finally tagged. So I don't know why that of Bamenda should be a different case.
Okay, you don't know why it should be a different case. Let's talk about some abuses that are ongoing in the northwest and southwest regions of Cameroon. Recently, some women were advocating for the defense and security forces to be investigated. They are accusing them of burning houses in Bui Division. And equally, we learn of rape cases. We are talking about a 13-year-old girl that justice is being demanded for. She was reportedly raped by a taxi driver in the southwest region of the country. So I just want to put it to you. You work for an organization that is for the defense of the rights of people who don't have the power to do whatever they can do to bring perpetrators of rights violations to order. So what have you guys been doing as far as this conflict is concerned to ensure that the rights of some people who are unjustly arrested and detained are secured?
Well, since 2018, I've been working with one of the organizations, Nouveau-Droit de l'Homme. There's a coalition that we created in December 2019 about some coalition for the a coalition that we created to that effect with our partner Mandela and Rather Long, that we have been working tirelessly to make sure that we monitor, document and report the cases of violations and abuses by both the separatist fighters and the government forces. Mm-hmm. So since then we have a lot of report that we have did to that effect, and we made numerous propositions to the government and to separatist fighters to make sure that we come to an end on the situation. Because there are a lot of things going on, not only the government forces that are committing, they are violating human rights. They probably have a lot of abuses that have been committed by the armed separatists. So among the recommendations that we made, there was a recommendation where we solicit for the government to make sure that ensure that there is a means to do everything possible to sit down with the separatist fighters and to dialogue. Because the best way of coming out of crisis also is to sit down and dialogue. And amongst other things, we were calling on the government to ratify the national laws against forceful disappearance, because the government has not ratified the law, and in this current armed conflict, there are a lot of people that are still missing. So we equally called on the Minister of Justice to make sure that the state prosecutors and at every jurisdiction publish the list of all Anglophones who have been arrested and detained arbitrarily, so that people will know whether their loved ones who have been missing are still alive or they are dead.
Okay. Monsieur Tarnteh, en tant que défenseur des droits de l'homme, j'aimerais qu'on revienne un peu sur le cas dont parlait Lasha ce matin, tout à l'heure, parlant de la fille de 13 ans qui a été violée. J'ai envie de savoir, qu'est-ce qu'on fait finalement de ces violeurs-là? Récemment, on a sorti une sentence a été délivrée pour les LGBT, les homosexuels au Cameroun. Il y a par exemple l'un de ces homosexuels-là, Shakiro, qui a été condamné à 5 ans de prison. Qu'est-ce qu'on fait pour les violeurs?
Well, actually, normally the human in human rights, when you have case of rape, a case of rape normally is not a case, it's not a human rights violation. It is a crime that punishable by national law. But should in case they take the matter is reported to the state, or maybe the current judiciary that is supposed to handle it, like the police or the court that is supposed to handle the matter, and at the end, justice is not rendered to the victim of the offense. It's from then now on that you become a human rights violation. So that's how we see the situation. But actually, with regards to the other one you were talking about...
Je vais dire au Cameroun, la punition d'un violeur, est-ce que c'est comparé à la punition, par exemple, d'un homosexuel, de quelqu'un qui est accusé d'actes d'homosexuel?
No, I think there are two different things, because normally we know that the Cameroon law is completely against homosexuality. If anybody is practicing anything as such here in Cameroon, I think it is a crime and should be punishable.
Oui, okay. Naturellement.
Naturally, we Africans don't believe in any research. We know in Africa that, first of all, the appellation homosexuality, I don't think those things have their own appellation in African context. No, that's why we see homosexuality and lesbianism as evil in African culture. So I don't think it is something that is acceptable yet. Maybe with time,
Cameroon. Non, je ne suis pas en train de dire, je sais justement, je suis en train de vouloir qu'on essaye de comprendre pourquoi la justice ne s'applique pas autant également, par exemple, pour des petites filles ou des garçons qui se font violer, pourquoi on n'applique pas autant cette justice-là, comme on applique lorsqu'on découvre, par exemple,
there are so many people who have disappeared in Bamenda, who have been violated of their rights. I know there's a daughter to the former director of Agri-Technical School in Bambele who has been missing now for over 2 months. She's nowhere to be found. Those are some of the things that your NGO should be investigating to ensure that whether these people were arrested or taken by the military or the Amazonians.
Yes, normally we know that we cannot handle all the cases at once, because the one that we have information to that effect, we make sure that we send people in the field to monitor the situation, so monitor the, so we can document and report same. So we should keep, as I already said here at the beginning, I was saying that our coalition has been calling for the government to make sure that she ratified the international conventions on forceful disappearance. But the Cameroon government has not ratified that law before. So we are calling on the government to ratify that law, and we're calling for the Minister of Justice to make sure that all the prosecutors, all the prosecutors at the different subdivisions, everywhere there's a court, they should make sure that they publish the list of all those who have been arrested and detained arbitrarily as a result of the ongoing crisis, so that people should know exactly if their loved one, whom they have not seen for quite some time, are still alive or not.
Okay, let's talk about the COVID-19 money, COVID gate money that has disappeared. Over 15 billion, talking about that money. And this paper is saying that Manawuda Malachi is a victim of efficiency, because he's done his job well. He's been accused, some of his political opponents want to use the COVID gate to nail him down. When you look at the money, 180 billion and 15 billion just shared by ministers, as if nothing happened. What are you human rights defenders doing? That's money that was meant for Cameroonians, to protect Cameroonians from the deadly coronavirus.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Lasha. Normally, the money was meant to protect Cameroonians from the virus, and from according to what I'm seeing on the newspaper is saying that Manawuda Malachi, the Minister of Public Health, is a victim of efficiency.
Yeah, he managed the money well, and people who are jealous of him want to pin him down. That's what the paper is.
Normally, for now, there are those ministers who have been accused are still benefiting from the human rights, like what we call presumption of innocence. Because presumption is innocent, when something happens and you are still under investigation, you are presumed to be innocent until proven otherwise. So they are still benefiting to that effect, but we cannot conclude here by saying that.
But the reports of the audit bench of the Supreme Court.
It's not a verdict of the courts. So it's the court that had final say. It's the court that had final say. But when I saw on the newspaper, and the newspaper is saying that a victim or whatsoever,
Where is the money? If they are saying that they are not invested, where is the money?
At the end, we'll
what
know
have
where,
they done with the money?
I think that at the end we'll know where the money is. So
because sometimes
the
Cameroonians have the impression that you, human rights defender, you defend almost everything, even evil. You defend evil.
No, we don't defend evil. I told about the principle of the presumption of innocence. The issue is that we are defending the law. We are here to protect the law and protect our society too. So we are not like defending anybody. If I was defending somebody, I would have said that maybe it's true that Manawuda Malachi is very effective, or he's very efficient on what we are saying. But the fact that he has been very active on the field does not make him efficient. He can use that opportunity of being active on the field to steal public money, so which is okay. Incorrect. Normally, we would condemn all sorts of things. After they have stolen the money at the end, they would condemn all sorts of things with all our last energy.
Okay, Audrey Zaza, we have barely 2 minutes.
Si on peut parler un petit peu des 27 7 militants du MRC qui sont encore en détention ce jour. Ils étaient attendus hier au tribunal à Yaoundé, mais leur cas a été renvoyé.
Let me use this opportunity once more to say that we have condemned, and we still keep on condemning the arrest of these freedom fighters. They are defenders of democracy, defenders of the voice of the voiceless. If people have this freedom, it's the right for someone to have freedom of thought, freedom of opinion, and freedom of assembly. We have the right to express ourselves. So that's why we have been condemning with all energy, calling on the government to release all those who have been arrested for exercising their freedom of assembly or freedom of opinion. Because it is absurd that we see our government to go ahead and begin to arrest people who are exercising their rights. Those rights were supposed to protect them, said by the government, because our Cameroon government have ratified numerous regional and international treaties, conventions.
But the government is using the anti-terrorism law to...
No, government is using all these anti-terrorism laws.
The laws were made by our own MPs.
The government is using all these anti-terrorism laws to silence opposition in Cameroon, because what we are seeing today is that anybody who raises off his voice...
But is it the government that made the law?
It is the government that controls the law. Most of what we know is that the bills that have been tabled in parliament for whatsoever is doing, it's for the government. That's why it's very difficult for you to see the opposition party to power, their own bill to pass on through the National Assembly. What we want here in Cameroon, we know the regime we are into, so we should not pretend as if we are not Cameroonians.
Okay, Amadu Tarnteh, thank you so much for coming. I will hope to have you some other time. You are a member of the Mandela Foundation.
Mandela Center.
And we'll ride along. And you guys are into human rights. You defend the rights of minorities in the country. Rights of those who don't have the voices to stand up for themselves. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you very much. It's really a pleasure to be here today.
Okay, Audrey Zatsa, we've come to the end of the program.
C'est la fin de cette émission, madame, messieurs. Merci d'avoir été des nôtres.
Thank you for watching, televiewers. The program was produced by Christain Tebong, as usual. For presentation, we've been Audrey Zatsa, myself, Lasha Kingsley. See you tomorrow for yet another edition of What the Papers Must Have Said. Bye-bye.